Shut it down!
Shut it down!
Shut it down!
I'm going to pass over the megaphone to Chris, who will read Andrew's story. And after this, we have a Reverend Diane Baker's here to do a prayer. And so we'll have that in a bit of a moment of silence.
I'm reading the story of Ann Jarrell. On Good Friday, March 29, 2013, I was at work and my daughter and new grandson, who was born on December 11, 2012, were at my house where they had been living since the birth of Logan. So I could help take care of both of them. My daughter, Jennifer, called me at work and told me I need to come home. There were police and fire trucks everywhere and it smelled really bad, like a gas leak. I drove home and the smell was getting stronger the closer I got to my house. When I walked into the house, Jennifer was frantically packing a bag for her and bags for Logan, and she told me to pack a bag so we could get out of there fast. I asked her why she thought we should leave. Had someone told her we needed to evacuate? She said no, but they taught her at school that if you can hear it, see it, touch it, or smell it, you need to leave the area immediately. I wanted to confirm we should leave, so I called the Mayflower Police Department and told them that we had headaches, we were very nauseous, and the smell was terrible. So did we need to evacuate? He asked me, do you have oil on your land? I told him no. Then he said, if there's not any oil on your land, you do not need to evacuate. My daughter was insistent that if this was a natural gas leak, then we need to leave. So I asked if there was a natural gas leak, and he told me no, this was an oil leak. And what we were smelling was the smell they put in the oil lines so they could tell if one started leaking, just like they do with natural gas. So we stayed. A week or so later, I saw an Exxon truck just past my driveway, and I told the lady from Exxon about the headaches and nausea. She said it would be gone in a couple of days and would not hurt us. So we stayed. There were 22 houses that had their residents ordered to be evacuated, but several others in the Northwood subdivision and close by also self-evacuated because of the symptoms of the toxic fumes. There were some residents that were told a hotel room would not be covered for them because the air quality tests showed to not be above a level of concern, and they did not have oil on their property. Since so many of us were sickened by the toxic fumes, I believe the level of concern should be reviewed for residents breathing it in 24 hours, 7 days a week. My family and several of our neighbors became very sick and no one contacted us. I called the Arkansas Health Department and was told they could not take our information. I needed another department or phone number to call. I was not informed of any meetings until I saw a notice of them on TV after they were over. A neighbor tried to attend a meeting and was told it was only for residents in the Northwood subdivision. Over the next several weeks, Jennifer had two seizure type events and went to the ER and was given muscle relaxers. Loca was using two inhalers. He's an infant, remember? One every 2 hours, and had to use an electronic suction machine to suction him when he started choking, and was given antibiotics for infected lungs, sinus infections, ear infections, and made several trips to his doctor and to the ER. His doctor said he did not know what else to do for him, and we should try to find a specialist to take him to. He is down to using an inhaler once in the morning and once at night until spring, when he will be re-evaluated. I have had multiple health issues. I had headaches so bad I would wake up crying in the middle of the night. My eyes were so blurry I was afraid of driving. I was coughing so much I lost my voice. I felt lightheaded, could not remember or articulate my thoughts, and had to cancel a training class because I just could not teach. I made several trips to my doctor, trying different meds to get rid of the headaches, and nothing worked. On Monday, August 19th, I called in sick to work again because my head was hurting so bad. I was lightheaded, throwing up, having diarrhea, blurry vision, felt so tired I just wanted to sleep all day but couldn't because of the coughing, and I was having trouble breathing, even using both of my inhalers. On Tuesday, August 20th, I managed to drag myself back to my doctor, and he said I was running fever. I had infected lungs and laryngitis. I could not talk above a whisper. He put me on antibiotics and more meds and told me not to go back to my house. He told me to find a friend to stay with and not to go to work, just rest and come back to see him that Friday. Friday, when I saw him, I was feeling some better, and he told me I was not to return to my house. I asked if I could just run in to grab a few things, and he said no. Get a friend to go over, to go get whatever I needed, and do not return to my house ever. The toxins build up and are stored in fat cells, and just a few breaths of the toxic fumes would make me just as sick as I was on the previous Tuesday. I was lucky enough to have a friend who let me move in with them. So I paid for a house I cannot live in, and I have no idea what the future holds for me. Not knowing is the hardest part, especially since I continue to have health issues. I did not know we were breathing in toxic chemicals until April 22nd, when I attended an Earth Day meeting hosted by Faulkner County Citizen Awareness Group. I asked someone if the list of chemicals and symptoms I was reading was for BP, and they told me no, they were for Mayflower. I started crying and called Jennifer and told her she was right. We should have left right away, and for her and Logan to move in with her brother. My story is only one of hundreds of people who have been affected by the Mayflower pipeline rupture. I want you to understand that many of the residents in Mayflower, myself included, trust in the information and guidance that we received from government officials and industry representatives. We believed them when they said breathing the air was safe and the levels of chemicals detected were not harmful. While I was watching my grandson struggle to breathe, my daughter fell on the ground with seizures. Me with such bad headaches that all I could do was cry, coughing so much I lost my voice, trouble breathing even while using inhalers every few hours, eyes so blurry I could barely see, dizzy and confused and so tired that it was hard to get out of bed, and I did not want to do anything except sleep. I kept waiting on someone to come tell me we need to leave the area because it was not safe there. I kept thinking that a health department, a government agency, or an organization with or without the pipeline carrier's assistance could be designated to come to the residents and check on them. Tell them what they should do. Tell them what phone number to call for assistance. What I understand now, what has become clear since the time of the pipeline rupture, is that the health of my community has been compromised as collateral damage. The information we were given was inaccurate and incomplete, and that our trust was misplaced. If I want something to be done or I want to get answers, it is up to me to find out for myself. And I will get my story out to the world in any way that I can, so the next small town, the next community that is faced with such a disaster, will have an idea what to do and be better prepared than we were in Mayflower. I hope that in these few remarks, you may have been inspired to review procedures and guidance given to citizens impacted by exposure to oil and the related toxic chemicals, and that you will make it your personal mission to protect the health of individuals and communities who will face the future pipeline ruptures. Be prepared, because it is not if it happens, it is when it happens. Please, be prepared.
You're going to have to turn it up.